टीचर्स, सीनियर्स एंड माय फेलो कलीग्स, आई एम डॉक्टर अपूर्व माथुर, सेकेंड ईयर एमडी रेजिडेंट फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रेस्पिरेटरी मेडिसिन, एंड टुडे वी आर गैदर्ड हियर टू डिस्कस द केस ऑफ अ यंग मेल विद रेकरेंट मैसिव हेमोप्टिसिस. दिस सीसीआर इज प्रेजेंटेड बाय द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रेस्पिरेटरी मेडिसिन विद अ वैल्यूएबल कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ रेडियोलॉजी, कार्डियोलॉजी एंड एनाटॉमी. So in March of 2021, a young 30 years old male presented with complaint of massive hemoptysis. He had on and off episodes of mild to moderate hemoptysis since last 10 years. His blood saturation and the blood pressure were normal. However, he was mild tachycardic and tachypneic. There were no other associated respiratory complaints. There was no complaint of shortness of breath, chest pain, weight loss, fever, epistaxis, recurrent cold or joint pain. He had his first episode in 2012, for which he consulted a local practitioner and was given anti-tubercular treatment for 6 months without any confirmation of diagnosis. However, even after taking complete treatment, his symptoms persisted and he had recurrent episodes of hemoptysis. So he took multiple consultations and was managed conservatively. However, in March of 2021, he presented with an episode of massive hemoptysis. So he was a laborer by occupation. He was a non-smoker and non-alcoholic. However, he had a history of tobacco or gutkha chewing since the age of 10 years. He was a non-vegetarian. His bowel bladder habits and movement were normal and his sleep was normal. On general examination, there was pallor. However, there was no icterus, cyanosis, lymphadenopathy, clubbing or edema. Also, there were no discharging sinuses, nodules or skin lesions. On respiratory system examination, the chest was symmetrical. There were no appreciable abnormalities in the movement and expansion of chest. On auscultation, there was decreased air entry in the right infrascapular region. And the cardiac systemic examination was also normal. So, to summarize till now, he is a young male with episodes of recurrent hemoptysis since 10 years. There were no associated other respiratory complaints. The patient had history of taking antitubercular treatment. On examination, he was tachycardic, there was pallor, and there was decreased air entry in the right infrascapular region. So, now I invite the audience to discuss about the various differentials in cases of hemoptysis. Would anyone like to share some differences?
As the patient is young, we can go for cystic fibrosis and tuberculosis, ruptured lung abscess.
Okay.
Some cardiac causes.
Yes, sir, like AV malformations. It can be other causes like pulmonary embolism. Even in mitral stenosis, we can find hemoptysis.
Cancer, valvular heart disease.
Mitral stenosis. So basically, we can divide it into infectious, vascular, mechanical, and other causes, and pulmonary causes.
तो ये सीसीआर में इन्होंने कार्डियोलॉजिस्ट को भी इन्वॉल्व किया तो कॉमन सेंस से कार्डियक कॉज हो सकती है.
You have to first divide it into, you have to classify the causes. You just can't go from cystic fibrosis as the first possibility in this case. Why did you think of cystic fibrosis as the first one?
It's a young adult male, sir.
Young adult males, we have a lot of respiratory medicine and medicine consultants here. How many of them would first think of a cystic fibrosis as a cause of hemoptysis in young males?
Sir.
You have to have an infective cause first.
Sir, not more than 30, the third or fourth episode.
Okay.
Anytime you go for differential diagnosis, either go by anatomy or go by we are going for the anatomy, think of it, like trachea, bronchi, secondary bronchi, tertiary bronchi, bronchus, and then for the depth system, एंड उसके उसका उसकी फादर को नहीं उसने उसका पेरेंट कहना था कि पहले बुलाए उसका सिस्टर पैर फिर आप और पर्सन जाना चाहते हो प्लानिंग जो
discussing the differentials of hemoptysis, it can be divided into two major groups. First is pulmonary and second is non-pulmonary. The pulmonary causes can be due to infection, due to neoplasm, any vascular abnormality, there can be bronchiectasis and some rare causes like vasculitis, any developmental abnormality or foreign body infection. The infectious causes include tuberculosis, which is endemic in our country. Then there can be a fungal infection, lung abscess or pneumonia. The neoplastic causes include bronchogenic carcinoma, bronchial adenoma or lung carcinoid. The vascular causes can be due to pulmonary embolism or AV malformation. Then coming to the non-cardiac group, it can be further divided into three subgroups. The first is cardiac, which includes mitral stenosis, aneurysm of aorta and left ventricular failure. Hemoptysis can also occur due to some bleeding disorders like thrombocytopenic purpura, leukemia, hemophilia. And when the patient is on any anticoagulant therapy. The iatrogenic causes include trauma while doing bronchoscopy, while taking lung biopsy, or while doing endotracheal intubation. So then the routine investigations of the patient was done, in which we found the hemoglobin to, on the, hemoglobin to be on the lower side. The TNC and platelet counts were normal. His ESR was raised, but the liver function test and the renal function test were normal. PTINR was also normal. His viral markers were negative and we sent sputum for AFP smear, which turned out to be negative as well. So then the chest x-ray of the patient was done. Now I again invite the audience to talk about the findings in this x-ray. Can you find any lesion?
The chest x-ray is the physician's x-ray. I don't think we need to involve the radiologist in it. So again, the medicine residents and respiratory medicine people are thinking, who amongst the medicine resident will describe this?
Hilar lymph nodes are prominent. There is some sort of fibrosis that I can see in the right lung, lower zone, middle side, close to the cardiac chamber.
Fibrosis ki
tarah Hilar lymph nodes and
fibrosis.
Very young man, not smoker.
He thinks that the vascular markings in the middle and lower zones are not prominent.
So, as we can see in this X-ray, there are no bony abnormalities. The trachea is central. We can find a lesion in the right lower zone, which is heterogeneous opacity with some ill-defined margins. And also you can appreciate some tram-like appearance in the right pericardial region. And also, if you look closely at the diaphragm, there is a tissue breakdown also present here. So, on the basis of clinical radiological findings, we ruled out some following possibilities. First was infective causes, second was bronchiectasis, third was impacted foreign body, fourth was endobronchial carcinoid, then some cardiac causes, vasculitis and AV malformation. So first we thought of reactivation of tuberculosis as the patient had a chronic history of hemoptysis. However, there was no episodes of fever, no complaint of weight loss, and the sputum AFP was negative. Then the infiltrates in the right lower zone and hemoptysis were suggestive, and the tram-like appearance in the chest X-ray were suggestive of bronchiectasis. However, there was no expectoration and there was no clubbing. Similarly for pneumonia, as the history was chronic and there was massive hemoptysis and the patient did not have any toxic load, so the chances of pneumonia were also unlikely. Then for endobronchial carcinoid, there was no obvious volume loss on the chest X-ray. The cardiac examination was normal, and then we also did 2D echo, which was normal. Then we thought of some of the rare causes, like in cases of vasculitis, but there were no systemic signs or symptoms, there were no other complaints. For AV malformation, although there was massive hemoptysis, but since the saturation was normal and there was no clubbing, so chances of AV malformations were also slightly on the lower side. Then, since the patient had a history of chronic tobacco chewing, and we saw a localized lesion in the right lower zone, it would have been due to a foreign body infection. However, the patient did not give any history of aspiration, and he is a young adult, so chances are more in the pediatric and elderly age group. And also for malignancy, in malignancy usually the hemoptysis is scanty, and in our case it was massive. So, and the patient was young and the history was chronic, so chances of malignancy were also less likely. So this video was shot by the patient's attendant, showing his episode of massive hemoptysis, which was bright red in color, and the hemoptysis came with pressure. Then we decided to go for bronchoscopy to rule out any endobronchial lesion and to find any site of bleeding. So as you can see, we have crossed the vocal cords and entered trachea, in which you can see some secretions. Now we will reach the carina, where the trachea divides into right and left main bronchus, and we have entered the right bronchial tree, and in which we have entered the right lower lobe, in which some secretions were present, which were aspirated and were sent for to rule out any infective etiology. However, the rest of the bronchoscopy was normal and we did not find any endobronchial lesion growth, and there were no bleeding spots also present. So the infective etiology, we sent it for ALB smear, which came out to be negative, gram stain was also negative, biogenic culture was also sterile, and there was no also fungal growth. Now I invite Dr. Ashna Garg from Department of Radiology to talk about the CT angiography findings.
Good morning to all the respected dignitaries, senior faculty members and fellow residents. I am Dr. Ashna and I will be discussing the radiological findings for the case. So we started off with a plain chest radiograph, the findings of which have already been discussed, following which we went for a CT pulmonary angiogram. Now on the left of your screen is the film of the patient, and on the right is an axial cut of the CTPA, which shows an ill-defined heterogeneous soft tissue attenuating lesion right here in the right lower lung field with a central area of enhancement. Now when we looked at this central area of enhancement further, this turned out to be a vessel going into the lesion. On tracing this vessel further, we found out that the origin of this vessel was actually coming directly from the abdominal aorta, approximately 2 mm proximal to that of the origin of celiac trunk. And then it traversed superiorly in the right paravertebral space, posterior to the IVC, and this relation we can see here on your left. This then traversed upwards, crossed the right hemidiaphragm, entered the right hemithorax, and was seen as an aberrant systemic feeder artery going into the lesion. This next slide shows us the coronal cuts of the same, where in this particular film we can see this mass of consolidation or area of consolidation, which is being drained here by the right inferior pulmonary vein. So in view of the findings of an area of consolidation in the right lower lung field, which is being supplied by an aberrant systemic artery drained by a right inferior pulmonary vein and sharing its visceral pleura with the parent lobe, we considered a possibility of intralobar bronchopulmonary sequestration. Now, other differentials for the same lesion could have been a vascular malformation or an AV malformation. However, the caliber of the pulmonary arteries was within normal limits. There was no evidence of any nadus formation. There were no dilated tortuous vessels. So this possibility was less likely. Another differential could have been a neoplasia. However, for a malignancy of pulmonary origin, to separately derive a systemic arterial supply is slightly uncommon, and hence this was less likely. So in the end, we were left with the possibility of intralobar bronchopulmonary sequestration. That's it about the CTPA findings. I'd like to call back Dr. Apoor to take the case. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ashna. So the findings till now are, he's a young male with episodes of massive hemoptysis. On radiology finding, there was localized opacity in the right lower lobe, showing anomalous arterial blood supply to the lesion. The rest of the lung and the bronchoscopic evaluation was normal. And the final diagnosis based on the CT angio findings was intralobar pulmonary sequestration. So for its treatment, a multidisciplinary discussion was done between the Department of Respiratory Medicine, Cardiology and CTVS. And following treatment options were thought of. The treatment of choice in this case is surgical intervention. Conservative management is usually done in cases of mild to moderate hemoptysis. In this case, as the patient refused for surgical intervention, we went for embolization of aberrant artery as it acts as a bridge therapy. So now I invite Dr. Aditya Goel from Department of Cardiology to talk about the embolization.
The patient was diagnosed in case of sequestration of lung, and the treatment of choice was surgical management. But as he refused for the same and he was having recurrent hemoptysis, so patient was taken into cath lab for urgent intervention. So in next slide, this slide will discuss a little bit about the branches which are coming from the abdominal aorta. So here is the celiac trunk, and our aberrant artery which is coming arises somewhat near about here. You will see this in further slides. And there are other arteries which are right renal artery, left renal artery, superior mesenteric artery and common hepatic artery. So first of all, descending aorta angiogram was done for the patient to look for any aberrant artery supplying the sequestration part. So in this first picture, you will see there are some branches which are going. This is splenic artery, celiac trunk is here. So proximal to this, there is this artery. On the left side you can see, there is the artery which is originating just proximal to the celiac trunk and is going above the diaphragm and is supplying the tissue in the lower part of the right lung. So further, this we are using wire. We went through femoral artery access, right femoral artery access, and this is a Sims catheter, Simon's catheter. We engage the artery, we selectively engage the aberrant artery, and we can see the blood flow which is going from the aberrant artery and is reaching to the lower part of the right lower lobe of the right. So this artery was embolized selectively using the microcatheter. This one, the thin one is a microcatheter, procreate microcatheter, and we used PVA particles, polyvinyl alcohol particles, 500 to 700 micrometer size, and the artery was embolized selectively using a slow and controlled infusion of the PVA particles. So in this you can see the blood flow is going from the artery to the sequestration part. So there are temporary and permanent. The temporary ones are gel foam, which we commonly use, and the permanent ones are coils and glue, cyanoglamic glue is there, and the PVA particles are there, and coils are also of many types. This was, we could have used any other agents also, but this was available at that time in the cath lab also. So,
this is not the
And also, sir,
why you should use liquid and why you should use particles?
Sir, because if we are using glue, it is a permanent thing, and it would have, we could have embolized non-selected artery, non-targeted artery because of that.
It will
come back.
Ligation.
Yes,
it will come back. And from distal. We are going for the selective thing and we are going for the selective.
Yes, sir. And liquid could have...
Distal tip is not that, we are not having the...
And in the second slide you can see, as after the embolization was in progress, so the blood flow has decreased from this artery. It is only going through the proximal part of the artery and not to the distal. In this you can see the stain of the dye, which is which you can see as the blood, there is no blood flow distally, so there is a stain which is stagnant here. And there was one more artery found during the angiogram. There was the 8th and 9th posterior intercostal artery, which was also draining the part of the sequestration. So this artery was also embolized, and this is on the right side picture of the artery post embolization. And we will see the video also. This is a pictal catheter from the right femoral axis, and we are doing a aortic angiogram. And if you look closely,
and for the aortic, what is the difference in normal catheter and pictal?
Sir, normal catheter are of many shapes, but the pictal catheter is rounded. Because sir, there are very less chances of injury in this, and also the dye can be injected at much higher pressure than compared to normal catheters.
Different type of catheter for engagement of the heart as well as peripheral vessels. So usually we have tip, hole at the tip of the catheter, but the pictal catheter have a loop at the end, and the shaft has 9 or 10 holes. And if we give the dye, so probably it will immerse from the shaft. It will not pass directly from the tip of the catheter, otherwise the high pressure dye we inject through the pressure injector, that can damage vessel or heart. So pictal catheter is used whenever we used to give a high pressure dye load any structure to reduce the injury. So that's the difference between the different catheter. Otherwise all the different catheter has tip hole which can cause injury. So that is the main difference. Number two, the large amount of dye we can push to the pictal catheter, but the end hole catheter we cannot use large amount of dye to see the large structure. Dye is going from the proximal to distal and reaching the sequestration part. In the next slide, there is no dye which is reaching. This, sorry, the left part is not working. On the right side, you can see there is an artery which is going from 8th and 9th intercostal and draining into sequestration of lung. And on the right side, you can see. The flow was controlled and there was no flow from proximal to distal, and all the collectors were closed of the sequestration sequestration. So there are some pros and cons of embolization also. Pros are that it is used as a bridge therapy between the surgical management and conservative management, and also it was necessary also, and it is also used to maintain the hemodynamic stability of the patient, and it's also a minimally invasive procedure. But the cons are that while embolizing the septic artery, we can embolize the known artery as well. And it is not a permanent solution, and around 30 to 40% of patients has recurrence after embolization. Reason is that the artery may recanalize, there may some collectors will form, collector formation can occur. Yes.
In this patient, you have a young person who has refused surgery, so why are we choosing a temporary option? Why would you not want to use glue and permanently occlude the vessel so that there is no question of recurrence or collateralization? So that can arise, but a permanent option might be preferable in this situation.
Yeah, we could have used foils, but there are also studies to say that multiple sittings are required, that some people require two or three sittings.
for curling after that only permanent solution.
Sir, one thing is important for definitely the permanent solution is the best possible option. But the permanent is for the collaterals or the apparent supply at that time which is present there. But even after blockage, patient can develop collateral supply afterwards. So even if you embolize with the permanent objects or devices, you cannot be sure that patient will not develop recurrent hemoptysis because of collateral. So at that time, we have PVA particle. The important is the PVA particle causes bed, the capillary bed of the apparent supply. We can directly embolize and we can clot that part as well. However, with the coil or with device, we can close only the large vessel. We cannot go beyond that. And if we have different capillary bed, then that can be supplied from the different vessels, as this patient has two or three bed supply from the
vessels. The glue would actually occlude even the vessel?
Yes, the glue can occlude, but the problem with the glue is we have to keep in a short, urgent. Otherwise, tip of the catheter that can adhere at that point of time, and it is very difficult to retrieve the tip of the catheter. So glue is important, but again, because this was high flow, in that case, we cannot use very fast and sharp push with the glue. Otherwise, it will go from the vessel to pulmonary vein, and that can damage other vessels as well. So we have to give control and slow infusion, and that is the best object is PVA particles for that.
Thank you, Dr. Aditya. So after the embolization was done, patient was lost to follow up for 2 years, and after being asymptomatic for 2 years, he again presented in August of 2023 with an episode of massive hemoptysis. So an emergency aberrant artery embolization was done and the patient was advised surgical intervention. However, again the patient refused. So to discuss about the embryology of bronchopulmonary sequestration, I would like to call Dr. Prabhjot Kaur Chhabra ma'am.
Good morning everyone. This pulmonary sequestration is a congenital anomaly of the lung tissue in which either a segment or the whole of the lobe of the lobe of lung, it gets separated from the bronchial tree. So the whole of the bronchi, the trachea and the lung, they develop from the respiratory diverticulum, which first appears at the age of around 3 weeks of development from the pharyngeal part of the foregut itself. Then in the subsequent weeks, this respiratory diverticulum or the lung bud, it divides at its caudal end and two lateral outpouchings develop, which form the primary bronchi at the age of around 4 to 5 weeks. And subsequently, the secondary bronchi develop, the three secondary bronchi on the right side and two secondary bronchi develop on the left side. Further, these the secondary bronchi, they divide into the segmental bronchioles, and the conducting part of the respiratory system, it develops in the pseudoglandular stage by the age of the 17 weeks. Along with the development of the bronchi, the pulmonary vessels also, they develop and they branch according to the pattern of the bronchi. In the subsequent weeks, the respiratory bronchioles, the alveolar sacs and the mature alveoli, they develop by the tongue, and the alveolar development, it also continues even after the birth up to the age of 2 years and then up to 8 years also the development continues. Now if in pseudoglandular stage, if some portion of the lung, if it gets separated from the bronchovascular segment, then a sequestration or a separate mass develops inside the normal lung. And this sequestered mass is actually covered by the normal pleura, which is covering the rest of the lung. It loses its pulmonary supply also, and the sequestered portion is supplied by a systemic vessel which is usually the branch of the thoracic aorta in case of intralobar sequestration. And if an extralobar sequestration develops in the later stages, if the tissue gets separated, then it gets its blood supply from the thoracic aorta, from the abdominal aorta also. The extralobar sequestrations are more commonly associated with other congenital anomalies of the foregut, and even a communication can develop between the lung tissue and the foregut also. So these are the two kinds of the sequestrations. for telling about the incidence of the this particular case and the pulmonary sequestrations, I invite Dr. Niharika from the Department of Pulmonary.
Further discussing the literature on bronchopulmonary sequestration, it is a rare developmental disorder of the lungs. It comprises of 1% of the total congenital abnormalities. Bronchopulmonary sequestration is as rare as 0.1% to 6.4% of congenital lung abnormalities. Bronchopulmonary sequestration is an island of abnormal unventilated lung tissue which lies either inside or outside with in close proximity to the lung. It has no normal communication with the bronchial system and it does not take part in respiration. As we can see here that there are two types of pulmonary sequestration, intralobar and extralobar. So in intralobar sequestration, while development, the bud lies close to the close to it gets encased while development and it is inside the normal lung tissue, but it does not take part in respiration. While in extralobar, it does not get encased within the lung, it lies in close proximity to the normal ventilating tissues. And the origin is of intralobar is before pleural cavity formation, whereas in extralobar, it is after pleural cavity formation. Intralobar sequestrations are more commonly associated with infections, whereas extralobar are associated with congenital abnormalities. As we discussed that the intralobar sequestration share the common visceral pleural coupling, whereas extralobar have their own pleural coupling. The sex incidence of intralobar is equal male 1:1, whereas extralobar is 4 times more common in males. The intralobar margins are spiculated, whereas the extralobar margins are smooth. The common locations of intralobar are in the lower lobes, whereas the extralobar are more commonly seen in the subdiaphragmatic area and in the mediastinal area. The pathology of sequestrated lung. The sequestrated lung contains underdeveloped dilated ciliated bronchi with alveolated tissue. The bronchial dilation is due to the retained secretion and edema. When there is infection in the sequestrated part of the lung due to stagnant blood, there is increased chances of infection. So this, because of secretion and edema, it gets dilated and it compresses on the adjacent structures. Infection can occur and it can spread either by hematogenous spread or as the lung is lying in close proximity, it can form fistulous connection and then spread. At the impacted area, gets distended. The clinical features these patients usually present, mostly they are asymptomatic, but they can present with persistent exertional dyspnea, cough, expectoration, hemoptysis, which may be mitomycin, and recurrent lower respiratory tract infections because of the mechanism described. The treatment, while asymptomatic can be managed conservatively, surgical resection is the definitive treatment for sequestration, but while till surgical resection, aberrant artery embolization can act as a bridge in massive hemoptysis cases, as it was in heart patient. Research articles published, this was published by Mayo Clinic, which is a higher volume center in 2018 in USA, which reported 32 adults over a time period of 20 years with pulmonary sequestration, intralobar being 81% and extralobar being 19%. Another article published by Pediatric Surgery from Jammu and Kashmir in 2015 reported pulmonary sequestration diagnosed in a 2-year-old child who was previously hospitalized multiple times and treated as recurrent pneumonia before final diagnosis was made of sequestration. Another article published by Oxford in 2021 reported a 19-year-old female who was diagnosed by pulmonary sequestration by 3D reconstruction and thoracoscopic lower lobe lobectomy was done and it was performed successfully. Take home message, interdepartment coordination always gives a better understanding of the disease and management outcome. Higher pressure hemoptysis gives clue about the possibility of vascular origin etiology as it was in our case. Parenchymal shadows are always not irregular and it should be interpreted with clinical. I would like to thank Department of Physiology, Anatomy, Cardiology, CCR Review Committee and wonderful learning community.